All right, we're here with the testimony too. We got James. He is going to give his testimony. He's one of the leaders of the Hip Hop Christian Connection, my favorite spot to be in Indianapolis besides church. Got good hip hop Christian music, spoken word, everything is here, and he is letting me get his testimony to help somebody else out there. And James, I'm going to let you go ahead and tell a little bit about your life.
Yeah. I was saved in my youth. I grew up in a Christian home, but that didn't mean that it was a perfect childhood or an easy childhood necessarily. Mm-hmm. I was a preacher's kid, but even then, I still ended up with some emotional abuse. I had two strong women in my life who I loved dearly, but because of hurts that happened to them, they kind of reflected them on me, which meant they were very critical of my weight. And while I wasn't an inactive child, I was always heavy. I was always a big kid. And that caused me to be really insecure, especially about my weight, my ability to meet people and talk to people, be attractive to others. And at the same time, because I was a preacher's kid, I had a facade up and was really good at maintaining it. As far as anybody knew, I was, you know, happy-go-lucky, responsible, a good kid.
Like you should be.
Exactly. Exactly like I should be. And, you know, where I grew up, it was pretty constrictive as far as the church culture goes. Mm-hmm. So, oftentimes, I wasn't allowed to do a lot of the things that your average kid was allowed to do.
Right.
Which left you with the choice of either rebelling or not. And so I chose not to. I embraced it and kind of hid further in the facade.
Yeah.
Then when I was about 12 or 13, I went from an area in Massachusetts where I was at. My life revolved around church. I was there when the doors opened. I was there when the doors shut.
Mm-hmm.
I was there when they weren't supposed to be open because something was wrong. You know, and for a long time I lived in the parish behind the church. So, you know, I was there.
Right.
You know. And then I went from there to moving to Indianapolis where we didn't really have a church support system.
Okay.
Where my parents started to fight about church. It became a contentious, intention-filled subject in the house, which meant from the time I was about 13, even though I was saved, my church attendance was, for no fault of my own really, was somewhat sporadic and not, there was no place where we really put roots down to a large degree. So not only did I have my own insecurities. I had the fact that, you know, I was saved, but I still had these issues, and I didn't know how to deal with them.
Right.
That they had told me, read the Bible, pray, study, but they didn't tell me how to do it.
Right.
So I didn't know what the heck I was supposed to do.
Right.
And then I'm in this unfamiliar territory where I don't really know people, don't have my security blanket of church, really. And so I'm kind of left to my own devices, which was the opening that the devil needed to try to come in and take me out. What resulted in my teenage years to a large degree was, even though I was trying to have a relationship with God and trying to pursue him as best as I knew how, I still got into porn, developed an addiction. I was still putting up a front, not dealing with my own insecurities and hurts. I actually even developed a question. Well, first of all, I started to have a whole lot of doubts. It's easy when you don't really have the support system for the devil to start, you know, getting in your ear and talking about, well, you know, is it real?
Right.
Is God real? Does he really care about you? At the same time, because of all the emotional baggage I had, I even started to question my sexuality, which opened up a whole nother can of worms. And so I went through a pretty troubled time where, like I said, I had a front up. Nobody really knew what was going on, but I had a lot of secrets in.
Right.
That was just totally, to a large degree, taking over my life. Mm-hmm. Then I went to college. And I went to college at a secular school that had a Christian group on campus, but because of the culture of the college, mm-hmm. it was really up to us to be Christian on campus. Okay. There was nothing, you know,
wow.
there was nothing holding us to it. It was easy
right.
to fall to any kind of temptation,
right.
drinking, sex, drugs, whatever we mm-hmm. wanted to do. If we really wanted to, we could do it. There was nothing stopping us.
Right.
So being a Christian in that environment took dedication and conscious effort.
Right.
And that resulted in a circumstance that God really orchestrated that put me in another country, in a place where I didn't really know the language. Didn't
uh-huh.
I had one friend that I knew who came with me.
Uh-huh.
Didn't know where the churches were.
Wow.
And, you know, found myself all too often sitting in my bedroom
mm-hmm.
saying, okay, what am I going to do now?
Right.
And it was a crossroads for me. It was a line in the sand, if you will, where I was like, okay, either I'm going to serve God
mm-hmm.
or I'm not.
Right.
Either, you know, it's going to be me and him or I'm walking away.
Mm-hmm.
I'm done with it. Well, I knew enough about God that I knew I couldn't just walk away.
Mm-hmm.
So me and him wrestled. There was plenty of screaming, crying, just, you know, laying it all out there, wrestling with God, trying to figure out, okay, what is going on? Why am I like the way I am?
Right.
What can I do? Where do I go now? What I came out of that with was a determination to follow God,
mm-hmm.
no matter what.
Right.
I still had these issues.
It
didn't drop the issues.
Uh-huh.
I still had them.
Right.
But there was a determination that I wasn't going to give up.
Oh,
fast forward another year and a half. Now I'm out of school. I come back home, start attending a church on my own, away from, you know, my family's influence, and start getting involved. And for me, that was a big key. I started getting involved in the men's ministry, started meeting some men who were walking with God and who wanted to invest in me.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing that, we started reading The Way of the Wild Heart, which deals with a lot of those issues from your childhood and understanding how that can affect you later on.
Mm-hmm.
Which resulted in God using that book to really hit me over the head with me.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that I had had a facade up for so long, I had forgot what was underneath. And I can clearly remember waking up out of a dead sleep in the middle of the night. And while I wouldn't say God spoke to me in my ear audibly, I had the first thought in my head was that I had to break the facade, I had to talk about it, I had to tell someone, or I was going to spiritually die.
Mm-hmm.
I just knew I was going to die, and I knew it wasn't going to be a physical thing. It
right.
was going to be a spiritual thing. So the next day, I frantically text one of the leaders of the men's group I was in. I was like, I need to sit down and talk with you. And so he's like, yeah, sure. And we sat down, had coffee, and I started just pouring out everything.
Mm-hmm.
It was probably the first time I had ever really talked about all of it.
Mm-hmm.
There was stuff that starting to connect that I had never really thought about before.
Wow.
And he had come up in a similar way that I had, so he understood where I was coming from in many senses. And God used that relationship to help me recognize what the problem was
mm-hmm.
and recognize how to start to fix it. And then it was just about taking steps, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I had low self-esteem. So I started studying what God said about me.
All right.
When you read the Bible and really start looking for those things, you learn that you're more than a conqueror.
Right.
That, you know, you can do all things through Christ. That as a man, I am his son.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a prince. I'm a king. I am chosen.
Right.
And once you start to understand who you are in Christ, a lot of those insecurities don't really make as much sense anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started doing practical things about it too. You know, I didn't like the way I looked, so I started exercising. I started, you know, I joined a karate class because I'd always wanted to do it. But, you know, it was just like, okay. It was a Christian-based organization.
Right.
So I was around people who were going to build me up.
Right.
Which is also so important.
Man.
It's essential if you're going to deal with these issues, not only that you get with people you trust who can, you know, help you dig in and just really look at stuff, but also surround yourself with people who are going to be a positive influence.
Mm-hmm.
And really the third thing I did that was really important was I started serving.
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes God can deal with you most when you're serving others.
Mm-hmm.
When you're working for him in helping others with their problems, oftentimes you realize, okay, mine aren't really that bad.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, God just, you know, there's some extra grace, I guess, that just kind of starts flowing in your life. So through doing things like that, I was able to really start to deal with some of my issues. Not saying I'm there yet,
mm-hmm.
but I'm a whole lot farther than I used to be.